Every time you're out birding, you're likely to see birds engaged in various behaviors. Some could be singing, some carrying food, or some building nest. In this session, we will see how to match these behaviors to their appropriate breeding codes. But before I do that, I would like to talk briefly about what is breeding and why it is important to document breeding behaviors. So what is breeding? The definition is very simple. Sexual reproduction between male and female, animal or a plant, that results in an offspring. And what do birds do when they are breeding? So the very first thing that birds do is to form mating bonds during their mating season. To attract a mate, birds may produce complex songs, show off crazy displays. They do some dance moves. They keep moving their body parts. Offering food to their mate or constructing nests are also part of bonding. And once the bond is formed, then begins the nesting and incubating. Many birds may continue to care for their young until they can fend for themselves. So there is a lot of parental care also involved. So all these are part of the breeding cycle in a bird. When do birds breed? So different species breed at different periods of the year. In India, most birds are known to breed during the hot summer. This is why, if you notice, many of our Bird Count India monthly challenges during the summer involve documenting breeding behaviors or documenting songs. Breeding in summer will also ensure that the chicks will have ample food by the time they hatch in the monsoon. So with the rains, there is plenty of food. There are wildflowers producing berries. There are new shoots. There are insects. And so there are a lot of food for all kind of birds to feed and raise their young. But there are also other factors like appropriate climate and risk of predation, good nesting site. So all these factors are also considered while breeding. So for example, if a ground nesting bird, if in a particular habitat, there are lots of feral dogs, ground nesting birds may not choose to nest in that particular habitat because the predation risk is higher. Why is it important? So in previous webinars, those who have attended Bird Count India's webinars, we've talked about e-bird observations, how they are useful in understanding trends in bird abundance and their distribution. But even for many common species, we don't have enough information about their breeding ecology. So one example that I would like to share is pale-bill flower peckers. So in Bangalore and many other urban areas, pale-bill flower pecker is one of the commonest birds. However, we still don't know how long they incubate their eggs or how long it takes for the chicks to transform to adults. Then climate change can also have adverse effects on a bird's breeding ecology. So specifically, documenting breeding behavior can be very helpful. Scientists have shown that global warming can cause birds to breed earlier or have shorter breeding seasons. And this can change the quality of food. This can also have serious effects on the health of chicks and the bird population. Now we start with our talk on breeding and behavior codes and how they are seen in e-bird. So on the left-hand side, the panel with the colorful circles, this is how the breeding code will look like in your e-bird mobile app. And on the right-hand side, this is how it will look in the e-bird website. So the moment you click on a species on the website, it will give you a drop down and it will give you the abbreviations of the breeding code and what it means. I'm not going to talk about website in this session, but I'll just show you how to choose breeding code in the mobile app. So the moment you have the list of birds visible in your mobile app, when you tap on any species, a box with observation details will appear, which is on the slide, which is on number 2. And when you click on the add breeding code, you will see this drop down of colorful circle. So the colors of the circles are important, and we will come to that in the later slides. So in this slide, you can again see the screenshot of how the breeding code look like in your mobile app. Now choose the breeding codes only when you're sure that the species are within the breeding season and also within the breeding habitat. So if you see a yellow wagtail near a water body, you should not choose any of these breeding codes because yellow wagtails don't breed in India. So for species that are migrants that do not breed in this area, or species if they are present but it is not their breeding time, we will not choose any breeding code. What do the colorful circles indicate? So the darker the color, the stronger the breeding evidence. There are a total of 23 codes which go from weak evidence to strong evidence, and we will look at each one of them and when to select them. So breeding codes are divided into 4 categories. The weaker categories, where the observations where we are not very sure, but we probably have an intuition or we think that this is a breeding time, then we will choose breeding code observe. When we have the slightest possibility that the species is present because this is the breeding season, then we will choose the possible category. And there are other 2 categories, so let me just go through each one of it. To start with the first categories, so as I said, if you see a species that is outside its breeding season and breeding habitat, you need not choose any code. It can just be left blank. So in this slide, you can see a photo of 2 sandpipers. They are engaged in some activity, but it does not indicate that they are breeding because green sandpipers do not breed in India. So in case like that, we will not choose any breeding code. You just observe the species and that's it. Flyover. This is one of the most misused term or misused code by a lot of us, including me. I have done many mistakes while choosing this code. So flyover is used only for species that fly above you and are not going to use the immediate habitat below it. For example, if you're standing in a forest and if you see a flock of cormorants all flying in one direction, then you will use the code flyover. Because the cormorants are just flying above you, they are not going to use the habitat below them. They are probably going to some wetland for roosting or for foraging. Similarly, if you are standing in your balcony and if you see black kites, you will not use the code flyover because raptors, swallows, martins, these species are known to be in the sky most of the time scanning for food. So yeah, flyover again is not very important. If you are not sure, you can totally skip. It's okay. It's not a confirmed breeding code. We move on to the second category, possible. So what are some of the possible breeding codes? H in appropriate habitat. So for this code, you have to make sure that the species that you are seeing is in its correct breeding season and in its suitable habitat. So one of the example I would like to give you is pitta. One of most of us, most all of us, in fact, all birders like pittas. They are so colorful and I love their songs. So if you see a pitta in Bangalore during the winter season, you will not choose this bird, because in South India, pittas are winter migrants. But if somebody in Rajasthan or Madhya Pradesh see pitta in the summer season, then they can use this bird, because pittas migrate to north in summer to breed. So when you're using H in appropriate habitat, make sure that the habitat component and the breeding season component both are considered. In eBird's monthly challenges, flyover and this code H do not qualify for the challenges. Singing bird, again, it can be used for any bird that is singing. Also, remember, calling is not same as singing. Singing is much more complex. And when you encounter any bird, you can use this code. This code is also used for non-song birds. For example, if you hear hooting of owls or drumming of woodpeckers, you can use this code. Moving to the third category, probable. Probable, most of the codes that are used under probable, here the probability of that of a species breeding is slightly higher than observed or possible. So S7, which is singing bird present 7+ days. So it means that if you hear or see a bird if you hear a bird from a call singing from a same location over 3-4 days in a row, or 7 days or so in a week, then you can use this code. So for example, there is a small water body next to your house, and every night you are hearing a white-breasted water hen calling. So you can use this code, because this indicates that the bird is present there and it's establishing its territory. If a quail is calling from the same patch of trees for the last 3-4 days, you can use this code as S7. Multiple bird singing. I'm not sure how many of you can use this code, but in many places, like example Rajasthan, in the summer it is possible to hear 7. Around the same time, it's the breeding season for all these birds. I'm sure in a good forest habitat you would also encounter that you will hear so many birds singing at the same time, and at that time you can use this code. Pair it suitable habitat. So this is a bit tricky to use. Now if you see a pair of common mynna, or say a pair of babblers or crows, I would not use this code unless and until I'm sure that they are a bonded pair. There is some bonding between the pair, because these birds are usually known in groups. They can be seen together anywhere and even in any kind of habitat. Another example is spotted doves. So if you see a pair of spotted doves and there are trees around that they can use as nest sites, then look for signs whether the pair is a bonded pair. And how will you look, how will you know the signs? Observe if they are sitting close to each other, breeding each other. Sometimes you will see the singing bird will bob its head up and down. So if you see all these signs, then you could use this code. But remember, again, if you're not sure, you can totally skip this code. It's not a confirmed code. So this means, this is territorial defense. This means that the bird is defending its territory and it's trying to chase off or fight any other bird that comes closer to its territory. So example is a gray-headed swamp hen. If you see a swamp hen raising its wing and trying, being very aggressive, trying to chase off another swamp hen in the same area or a mole hen in the same area, then you could use this code. Sometimes you will notice that purple sunbirds, when they just start their eclipse plumage and they start vocalizing, singing, and if there are other smaller birds around, they will try to chase it away. See, courtship, this is a very straightforward thing, that if you see any bird, if you see any species engaged in courtship, display, or mating, you can use this code. Sometimes you would notice that even parakeets, like you will see a male parakeet feeding, regurgitating food and feeding it to the female parakeet. So this is again part of offering food, is also part of courtship ritual. Visiting probable nest site. So if you notice a species repeatedly visiting in the same bush or in the same cavity again and again and taking some time to come out, this could indicate that there could be a nest site. So if you see an Achiprinia going in the bush, same bush, and every time it goes in, it takes some time to stay inside and come out, it means that there could be a nest inside. So even for cavity nesters like barbets and woodpeckers, if you see them going inside a cavity and staying there and coming out after some time, this could indicate that it is a nest. Agitated behavior. So if a bird is giving distress call or it is trying to call loudly, it's appearing restless, it's trying to fly up and down in the same area. So this indicates that the bird is trying to chase away the predator. There could be a nest or young ones around. So look for such signs, what exactly the bird is doing, whether it is defending its territory or whether it is showing signs of aggression. So when you're choosing this code, like territorial defense or agitated behavior, just be very sure what code you're choosing. Now it does not, this behavior does not apply to birds like drongos or crows, which are known to mob other birds throughout the year. Also, many a times when there is a raptor around, say a shikra flies in, then all the smaller birds like sparrows, bilboos and all will give out distress call. So that does not mean that it is a distress call made because of breeding. It is because they are scared of the predator and they want to warn others. So again, be very careful when you're using this code. Now, this is very interesting. I had not known that woodpeckers, many cavity nesting species like woodpeckers and barbets, they can make dummy nests. So, and woodpeckers are also known to make holes for roosting. So when you see cavity nesting species like barbets and woodpeckers, you can use this code. Because again, we are not sure whether the hole that they are making is a confirmed nest or whether it's going to be a dummy nest. Moving to our last category, which is also the strongest breeding codes. And whenever you see strong signs of breeding, please, please use breeding codes for these. Now, physiological evidence. So physiological evidence means the bird is in your hand and you can see signs of it breeding. So it could be like brood patch, like you can see the pink flesh. So this brood patch is where when the birds are incubating the eggs, the heat is transferred to the eggs. So many breeding birds, you will see this brood patch or egg in the oviduct. So it is mainly used by bird banders I think some of the birders here who are also involved with bird rescues, they might have also come across such brood patch in certain species. Okay, so be careful, do not use this code. It's only used when the bird is in hand. Okay, I'm going to stop here for a minute. Just going to drink some water and be back. Meanwhile, if you have any questions, please type it in the chat box. Okay, so carrying nesting material. When you see an adult carrying nest material such as sticks, grass, or swallows carrying mud, soil in their beak, or sometimes birds also carry cobwebs to add finishing touches or building their nest. If you see such things, then you can use this code. Be careful while using this code for raptors, because many a times raptors, birds of prey, when they swoop down to catch their prey, many a times other items also get caught in their talons. Sometimes they might miss the food completely and just are left with stick or strings or grasses. So when you are using this code for raptors, make sure that the material that the raptor is carrying is for nest building and it is not by accident that it has caught it. So nest building, this code is only to be used when you spot the actual nest site and you observe the species building it. So if you see a bird building a nest, you see the nest site and the bird doing it, constructing it, you will use this code. Again, if you see woodpecker drilling, a barbet drilling, please use the previous code that we talked about, which is B. Woodpecker nest building. In your comments, even if it is a barbet that you're seeing, you can use this code, and in the comments you can write that if you have seen barbet drilling a hole. So distraction display, this code is used when birds try to distract intruders. So if an example is if there is a dog sniffing around in the ground and the dog is probably moving towards a Indian cursor's nest, and the Indian cursor will open it one of its wing and pretend that it is injured, and it will walk, start giving out some calls and walk in a very lopsided or in a very injured way. So this means that it is trying to distract the predator away from the nest. So many birds do that. So even lapwings, if you are walking and if this is the nesting time of the lapwings and suddenly they start giving out calls and they are trying to mob you, then it is a possibility that there is a nest around. So you could use this code. So you came across a nest, but there are no birds seen nearby. So you could use this code. But you have to be sure that you know what species that nest belongs to. So if you know that the nest is of a drongo, because you had seen the drongo build it last year, but it is now not being used, then you could use this code. You have to add details in your comments on how you identified the nest, to which species this nest belongs. And as I said, you notice the nest, but no birds around. But if you know what species it is, then you can enter the count 0 for that species. So in this slide, the nest is of a red whiskered bulbul. The adult is not around, and the nest is not active. So the observer can enter red whiskered bulbul in his checklist, but the count will be zero. And in the comments, he can write why he knows that it is a red whiskered bulbul. Now, occupied nest. This code is very useful for nests that are high up in the tree or on cliffs or on pylons. It is difficult to see what's inside the nest, but you know that there is a nest there, and you have seen the adults taking turns in incubating it or sitting on the nest. So here there is a lovely red-necked falcon sitting in a stick nest made on high on top of a pylon. We don't know whether there are eggs, whether the eggs have hatched, or whether the bird has laid the eggs or not, but you can use this code. Now, recently fledged. So when you see chicks which have really soft, fluffy, cottony feather, also known as down feathers, and you will, in some chicks, you will also notice that they have a yellow gape line. Now, this is what a gape line is here, where the beak line goes. They can open wider mouth, begging for food. So the gape line is quite big in chicks. The tail is short, shorter than the wings, and you can see a lot of fluffy feathers here. And these birds are still dependent on adult birds. They can't fly. Even if they try to fly, they keep falling down. So in a case like this, you will use recently fledged. And moving on to our next code, carrying food. So if you see an adult bird carrying food, it could be for, it is carrying food either for the young or for its incubating partner. So you can use this code carrying food. However, be careful when you're using this code for raptors, kingfishers, terns, and a lot of other species that are known to carry food for courtship or simply caching. Caching means holding. They just are just collecting the eggs. So many a times crows also do that. So be careful when you're using this code for some species. So one way to find out is to just stay put and keep watching if the bird is again carrying food and going in the same direction. If you see multiple times the same species flying in the same direction with mouthful of food, it is confirmed that it is carrying food either for its mate or for its young. Now, feeding young. So the juveniles are out of the nest. They are no longer in the nest. They are out of the nest, but at the same time, they are still not independent. They are still dependent on the adults to feed them. So in a case when you see an adult feeding a juvenile which is out of its nest, you will use this code. There is another code which we will come towards the end of our talk, which is nest with young, which is again very similar, where the adults are feeding the juveniles, but the only difference is juveniles are still inside the nest. They are still in the nest, not out of the nest. So I'm not sure how many of you have observed this, but if you have a breeding bird, birds breeding nearby you, it is worth observing whether they do clean the nest or not. Many songbirds, they carry the fecal sac, which is very white and very membranous, softy tissue-like thing, or sometimes also broken eggshells from the inside of the nest, and they take it outside. So woodpeckers and songbirds are the only species that produce fecal sacs, and this code should not be used for non-passerine birds. I think Shashank can type in the chat box and give some examples on what are passerine birds and what are non-passerine birds. Yeah. So, Shashank, tell me once you have given a few examples in the chat, so that then I can move on. I can move on to the next slide.
I've just pasted a link to an article which talks about what a songbird is.
Okay, so passerine birds are songbirds, and yes, please refer to the article for those who would like to know the difference. Nest with eggs. So when you come across a nest, the very first thing is not to disturb the nest with eggs, because you know the adult bird is somewhere around. If you do not know what species that nest belongs to, stand at a reasonable distance and keep watching, and you would notice what adult comes to this nest. So, yeah. What happens if you see, there is another white color or a blue color egg. So two or three eggs look very similar, but one egg is different. It could be an egg of a cuckoo. It could be an egg in a crow's nest. You would see that all eggs look same, but one egg looks very different. It could be a quail's egg. So when you're sure about both the species, that is the host species and also the brood parasite bird which has laid its egg in other bird's nest, when you're sure about both the species and their eggs are in one nest, then you would use nest with eggs poured for both species. So if a quail's egg is there in a crow's nest, you will put nest with eggs for quail also and also for crow. So remember, we were talking about feeding young. Feeding young, the chicks are still in the chicks are already outside the nest and being fed by adults. And nest with young is the chicks are still inside the nest. Whether you hear them or see them, but you know that they are inside the nest, you would use this code. Now make sure when you are putting the count, you will also include the chicks. If you know that there is a scenario take nesting in a cavity or in a electric meter box or whatever in a cavity, and you've been seeing the adult birds carrying food on many occasions, so it means that there are chicks inside, but you just don't know how many they are. So in this case, it's fine. You will just enter the adult birds. But in case where you can see the chicks in the nest, you will also enter the count of the chicks.